So what's happening with Facebook Watch, which made a big splash, but there are a lot of questions about where it's been.
So what's interesting about Facebook Watch is in the beginning, in 2016, when this was conceived, it was more about creating a different way for people to use Facebook. One of the things that we'll be hearing more about this week during earnings is how Facebook has really reached a saturation point around the world in terms of global usage and its biggest ad markets. So Watch was supposed to get people to use Facebook in the more lounge-like experience, like when you're cuddled up in your couch watching Netflix, maybe you would want to watch Facebook instead. So far, that has not happened. Facebook Watch has a minority of Facebook's users. It has not had any really big hits, and really the company is you know, not getting to the point where they're competing head-to-head with YouTube the way they envisioned they would, at least not yet.
So what's Facebook saying about it?
Facebook is saying that they consider it a success, that it's early days, that they know that there's consumer behavior to have this kind of active, intentional viewing experience, but that they haven't really gotten there yet before. One thing that's really interesting that my sources told me about this whole thing is back in 2016 when this was conceived, Facebook was taking an average of 45 minutes of users' time per day, but that was split up into little moments, less than 90-second sessions on average. People were looking at Facebook while they were waiting in line or waiting for the check. It was these moments of the day that in aggregate turn into an amazing, gigantic global advertising business, but they don't have a lot of sit-down, intentional viewing. It's more passive.
Now, with results coming up, despite all the bad news about Facebook, analysts are still expecting the biggest profit ever in a single quarter, right?
Well, Facebook has so many options beyond Facebook, beyond Watch. This is a humongous business now with the likes of Instagram and Facebook Messenger. And, you know, they're starting slowly to monetize WhatsApp too. Most of the growth I think we'll probably still see from the main Facebook app, which is continuing to grow in emerging markets, despite the controversies here in the US. What we'll be wanting to see though is whether those main markets have really reached a saturation point in terms users in the U.S. and Europe and other places like that.
Right. Now, meantime, Nick Clegg, the new head of policy and comms, is on board, you know, big U.K. former political figure. What does he bring to the table?
He is going to try to be the independent voice at the top of Facebook, telling them, here's what's going to work, here's what's not going to work when you talk to regulators, when you talk to the public, here's what people don't like about you guys. Facebook has had a big problem with not understanding how the public views how they work and how they need to get better, and so maybe he'll bridge the gap. But so far, it looks like he is out there kind of touting the same solutions that Zuckerberg has touted in the past, which is a more independent oversight of Facebook content policies and an expansion of the same tactics they used around the 2018 midterm elections.
Here's Nick Clegg in his former life as a UK. A politicker. Meantime, Snap, in search of new executives, the CFO recently left. They've hired or appointed an interim CEO last week. Do you know her?
She is one of the rising stars at Snap. I know there's been a lot of turnaround at the top there, so people can rise quite quickly. But, you know, she's an interim option. They have said that they are going to initiate a search. So we still don't know who's going to be the long-term CFO at Snap. Tim Cohn was in the role for much less than a year. So it's going to be incumbent on them to find somebody who can really have a more stable approach with Wall Street. There's been a lot of volatility with that stock.